The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, Billy, as always, and I am joined on this edition. We are hashtag for the craft with Paul Dawson. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure.
So you contacted me to be on the show, which is nice. It's kind of rare nowadays. I'm doing the chasing for people, which... it's fine. I'm getting great guests because of it. But it's great to speak to someone that wanted to be on initially. But the first question is always the same. We'll just get straight into it. Is how did you get into pro wrestling? What got you hooked?
That's quite a big question, I think. It's wrestling was always something like that attracted me, like a wee guy. When I was like 5 or 6, I was given like a couple of wrestling figures. I didn't know what wrestling was. I had maybe seen it on TV once or twice, and I just... was quite confused what it was. I gave him a couple of figures, and then from there it continued. I started watching like SmackDown on Sky One on a Saturday morning, and I've seen people like The Undertaker and like the Great Khali and Rey Mysterio and stuff, and it kind of like, oh, these are big characters and stuff. And then when I got to like maybe P5, P6, I kind of fell out of love with wrestling. I guess it happens to everybody. You kind of have a period where they kind of don't know what they want to do. And wrestling wasn't something I was really looking forward to. But then I turned about, I think it was at 14, 15. I think I was just going for online, looking at stuff. And, oh, there's wrestling. I used to watch it. I'll get a wee watch. And it was like CM Punk and Daniel Bryan. And these great wrestlers and great characters and great talkers. And I always seemed like I'm a massive fan of literature. Like, I'm an English literature student, so I always loved storytelling. And I was watching stuff like Daniel Ryan and the Team Hell No stuff. Like, that was a great story, and I love stories. And then from there, I started picking up wee small stuff, and I started getting more back into wrestling. And then I was like, you know what? Wrestling would be quite good. Like, I'm into my boxing and my MMA. I could try and see if I can find a way to do that. Because I was doing amateur wrestling at the time as well. So I was like, you know, there's probably a way I can find a wrestling school in Scotland. And I had a wee look. And a lot of them, like, 18-year-olds, I need to be 16, because I was about 15 at the time, and I was like, fuck. And then I seen one in Barhead, and I was like, okay, that's quite close, it's not that far away. And I was like, I'll go and see what it's like. And I went, and my dad was quite reluctant at the time. He's like, I don't know, you're a bit old for that kind of stuff. And I was like, no, I'll get a wee try, and I'll get a go. And then I just get hooked. I just loved it, because, like, and everything just came flooding back why I loved it. It was like, The grand stories, the character telling, just and the action as well. I won't say this, I'll be afraid to say this. In boxing, I'm quite a counter attacker. I like getting punched in the face and stuff, I like getting hard hits and stuff like that. And wrestling, that's what goes from then. It's like, going in the back and keep fighting, and it's like the underdog story. And it's quite like sloppy and all that, but that's what got me into it, and I love it for it.
I find it's kind of the irony, that's not the word, I'm not a last march set, but your dad's saying that. You think you're too old for it. I think 16, 15, 16 is probably when your body's maybe developed enough to withstand doing that sort of thing. Because you're still growing, of course, at that time. I mean, fair to anyone who tries to train at, like 14 and under, but your bodies are just going to take a hammering and they need to develop. So it's that seems to be the kind of time to do it. Folk are in WWE now and they started training in 14, so who am I to judge in that respect? Do you remember what your first wrestling figures were then?
Okay, I think it was stuff like maybe like Jeff Hardy, stuff like that. I think, who was it now? I think there's a couple of TNA figures in there as well. I think it was like one of the and I was down the bus and just picked up a few ones seen. And so I got like, I think, oh, Sonja Dutt, that's the one I remember. Sonja Dutt was one of them. And I don't know why I remember that so vividly. Like a Sonja Dutt figure when I was like 6 years old.
That is so cool. I never saw the TNA figures around right here, but I'm up in the Northeast. But I've always like, I used to love getting back wrestler figures. Jeff Hardy once again makes a mention on this podcast. I think again, everyone seems to be from about, if you started watching from about 2000 onwards, Jeff Hardy is there in your mind somewhere. So yeah, obviously you're making me feel really old because you started watching, and the first names you're saying is the Great Khali. So that's just made me think. Oh,
he's one of the first members, wrestlers you remember, it's like the Great Khali. It's like, fair play to him, we're all getting the Hall of Fame in that now, but just it's not a great memory to have.
Yeah, I mean, was it must have been Beast Khali then. It was when he started. Oh,
no, it was like Kidd and his manager, who I can't remember the name of.
Ranjan Singh. I remember these stupid things. but that's fine. At least it was a dancing Khali. I think that would have been I would have been surprised if he kept watching.
I don't think I was watching. Like, see, that time when he was dancing and stuff, I think that was like my period out. But I have went back and watched kind of went back and watched stuff like that. And oh, I feel bad for him.
Hall of Fame career.
Oh, I know.
can't deny that. So when it came to that first training session, and again, it's a question I ask a lot of people because everyone's got different answers. Some are, some thrive on pain. And if you have got a bit of a boxing background, that fighting back mentality, did you find the bumping quite okay, or was there a shock to the system?
Bumping was fine for me. Like, it's more just trying to get it right. Like, I'm a wee bit of a perfectionist. If I get something right, I want to get it done properly. And I kept trying to do it. I kept trying to do it right. And I just kept, like, going for it. And, like, it might be, like, I wouldn't say it was beneficial for me to, like, push my body to, like, limits it knows it shouldn't go. But I was trying my best. And I remember coming home and, like, I don't know who said it. Somebody in the background went, oh, if you're struggling with bumps, just try it on your bed. So I remember going home that night and, like, practicing, like, back bumps on my bed. And my, like, just people, like, I feel bad for people who live above me. They must have thought I was going mental, just hearing noise from down below. It was like just back bumps on my bed, and it was just, oh, it's weird. But I did enjoy it.
And of course, being at the school that you're at, I've interviewed quite a lot of people from that particular school now. Of course, you start on the mats and then the ring's the privileged bit of it. Did you get to work a bit in the ring before you made your debut? Did you get a bit of a run on the ropes?
Yeah, run the ropes was something when I first got it, I thought this is going to be really easy. And then it was a shock to the system. Sort of like, even like bumping the ring, I feel like it's still different from bumping the mats. I feel like bumping the mats is probably a wee bit sore than bumping the natural ring. So I felt like I was fine with that, but when it came to the ropes, I think I was unprepared. I could run them properly. I know the motion of running the ropes, but actually hitting the ropes, that like smack, it was like, I don't think you're prepared for it if you don't know what you're going into. Like I was told it was going to hurt, but I wasn't expecting it to be like that.
I mean, I suppose as someone who's never bumped, but in my head, with you, if you bump in a ring, there's space underneath, so there's a little bit more of a bounce to it.
Yeah.
But whereas if you hit a mat that's on a floor, there's nothing. There's nothing that'll budge for it. I was speaking to Krieger, and he was saying that he couldn't get running the ropes initially. He kept, because he's taller, he would keep sitting on the middle rope as he'd go, and he would end up just bruising his arse because of it. It's just... Yeah, I'm exactly the same. Again, this is coming from someone who's never done it, but I can understand the motion, your five steps, turn, and but like doing it and trying to get a rhythm. Again, I suppose I come from a boxer background. The rhythm's fine. It's just the actual shock of hitting it that would be the issue.
I'd hit ropes before when I was doing boxing, but that's more of when that's your own motion taking you back. But see, running against them, like you're forcing your body to go against it. It was like more of a oof. Oh, cool. That's a bit of a shock. It's like, I always imagined it as like, you ever been like, whipped with a towel? Like, it was like that, like a wee snappy whip. That's how I like, tried to explain it.
Okay. No, I'm with you.
It's painful, but it's like, oof, right, okay.
Right, well, that's...
Your body calluses.
Of course, as well with the drum. Sorry, your stream keeps me jumping a little bit, so I don't mean to interrupt when I'm going. I just think you've stopped speaking. Then I'm jumping in, but we'll be fine. Zoom has been an absolute pain in the backside recently. The recent episode with Jason Hyde, and my internet died 10 minutes in, just shut off. So we got it back, thankfully. But yeah, it was, I don't know, internet, a 15-year-old laptop that's doing it or what. But hopefully by the time season 3 rolls around, I'll actually have better equipment. But in the meantime, we'll persevere. So I'm thinking then you started training 2017, did I be right in thinking that?
Yeah, I think it was like the end of 2016, 2017, yeah.
And I've got down here that you made your debut in 2019. So just over 2 years, a year and a half training. I'm assuming it was a Academy Attack show, would that be right?
Yes, it was.
So what was it like being told you're going to have your first match in the ring in front of a crowd?
I just get a funny story in my debut. That I was told about a year before that I was going to make my debut, and I was still I think I was 17, maybe 16 at this point, and I spoke to my dad about it, and my dad bluntly said no, and then I spoke to my family, and they were all like, no, we don't want you to do it, and I was quite confused, because they're more happy for me to do like boxing and training and stuff like that, but I think they had more of a concern, because wrestling is a team sport. It's not an individual sport, whereas boxing, you know the risk, what you're going to do. You're going to punch in the face. You might have a wee bruise now and then. But wrestling, sometimes accidents do happen. And I think my dad just had a wee bit of fear in him. So he kind of pushed that back. But as I got older, I spoke to him and we kind of came to an agreement that it's my choice if I want to do it. That's perfectly fine. So when it came to my debut, when I was finally told, okay, you can do it, I was buzzing, because I knew I was ready for it, and I was more than happy just to go out there and do the best possible thing I could. Like, and I remember all my friends were absolutely buzzing for me, and my family were buzzing for me eventually, because they knew this is what I wanted to do. And I was really quite excited, because I'm not going to lie, I love being the big bad guy. I think it's fun. It's a good laugh. Just going up to people's faces and try to get them to hate you. Like, I enjoy doing it. It's a good laugh for me.
And you're in a team that I've gone on to be like just nasty people in the ring kind of thing. Danny Edwards, if I'm right. No, this is Big Mask Wrestling. Totally wrong. So what was your debut match?
Oh, it was me and a singles match. And I went in and I think we were just after the second half. And it was more of a thing like, okay, we've just came back for the break. You need to try and go out there and rise them back up, make sure they're all still on their feet. And I came in, and obviously when you first come in, you've got a wee bit of nerves and stuff coming in, and I was like, I just need to try and be big and boastful and try and get a reaction of people. So it's actually a wee bit funnier, is that halfway through, I'm like screaming at the ref, like, oh, that was a free count, that was a free count, and I've misspoken, like, that was a two count. And everybody's calling them and like, two, and I was like, ah, I've heard two, shut up, and I'm like kicking the ropes and stuff like that. And I've like just had to improvise off the top of my head, because I've like, I'm trying my best, like, and I've just said it out by mistake. And I thought, I was in my head going, oh, that's quite funny, just laughing to myself, because it made me look like, oh, a big, stupid, dafty, bad guy. And I like doing that, it wasn't intentional, but people were like, oh, that was quite funny what you did. And I'm like, no, that was not intentional whatsoever.
Do you think if you made your debut a year ago and the year before and you did that, you would have just been like, ah, no, I've done it wrong. Everything's off now.
Yeah, I would have crumbled. I would have absolutely crumbled a year before. So I think that year of training kind of solidified me of like, okay, you know what you're doing. You know what your character is. You know what this, that. A year before, I had no clue what I wanted to be. It took that year to get what I wanted to be.
And so you said you're like playing the bad guy, the big... daft baddie. Do you have like any, I mean, we'll get on to your writing in a bit, but did you do anything like drama or anything that were you quite a confident person in front of people, that this was kind of quite easy to come to, or was there any trepidation for your first match in that respect?
No, I've just always been kind of a open person. I'm quite confident. I don't know what it is, it's just I'm quite a in my natural environment, I'm quite loud and genuine. It's not like a bad thing to be loud. I think I'm just more confident. I'm not scared to talk to people. I'm not scared to approach people. Like, and I've always worked in environments where that's like told you need to do that. Like, I've worked in retail. I'm a barista right now. I used to work at Celtic Park where I had to sell to people individually. So I've always been kind of this spokesman kind of person to try and go out. And I've always just kind of enjoyed it. That's sort of thing. I think the gift of gab is something I've been blessed with.
That's like you're saying, and I'm in a total agreement. Things like story and moments and things like that, that's kind of the selling point for wrestling. The wrestling's almost secondary. So if you can do that safely, great. But if you're loud like yourself, if you're able to emote a story, then you're pretty much golden regarding wrestling, I would say. One of the training seminars I noticed you're a part of, because I do some research, you were in with Mark Coffey. Yeah. Did you get a chance to go in the ring with him especially, or was it, he's just kind of running the
We ran a few kind of stuff, and I got to ask him a few questions, because Mark Coffey is like, I think he's one of the better tag team wrestlers in the UK right now, and I think his work has always been spectacular. He kind of works this kind of style that I admire, the kind of rough and tumble, but can be both ways. Can be, oh, I'm a big stupid dafty, or I can be, oh, I'm the serious guy who's going to batter you. And I think that's quite, you know, it's a fine line to walk, and I think he does it quite well. And I'm enjoying his tag team up now with like Wolfgang, obviously, in NXT UK. And it's kind of resembling of like old school 80s WWF, when you've got your Brainbusters and your Demolition, and they're all kind of rough and tumble, but they can do both. They can make a story easily just through the reactions, but it doesn't like halt how serious you take them, which I think is quite a good, that's what you have to be even the bad guy. You have to walk that line. I think that's something Mark taught us very well, because he spoke very elegantly about it, how you need to treat yourself serious so you can be this big stupid dafty.
Yeah, because I mean, I suppose if you're just the stupid guy, then you'll never be, like, I think, trying to think of an example, like Santino Marella, I think would be a good example. He was a joke character, but was treated like a joke character. And in the ring, he was a joke character. So if he won, it was a joke kind of thing. But if you had a guy like, say like a Mark Coffey then, who could do the stupid things during the match, but always had this kind of killer bit as well that would just batter you. It's definitely a fine line depending on how you want to be perceived. So 2019 was pretty big for you though. So you did your debut. You're in SWA. I don't have a note of the match. I'm assuming it was Battlezone.
Yeah, it was a battle royal, yeah.
So how was that? New environment, new company, loads of different faces. How's like going into that kind of match?
That was mental for me, because I was told when I was in holiday that I got a message about you're going to be in this match. And this is my first lad's holiday, me and my pals. And I'm quite intoxicated at this point. And I just get a message about 3 a.m. in like Greece. And I'm like, oh, you're going to be in this match. And I'm looking at like, oh, what match is that? And I'm like, oh, it's for 800 people in Motherwell. And I'm like, pure shocked. And I'm like, pure loving it. And I'm like, messaging random people going, I'm going to be here and this and that and the third. And then when I got to it, I was quite nervous at first. But I was like, I've always got a thing, if you're meeting new people or you're in a new environment, treat it like a familiar environment, because they're not going to be much different. So I just treat it like it was a normal training match. Like, go out there and do the exact same thing you will do, just impress. And hopefully I did that. But I came out and it was dark, so you couldn't see a lot of people, but it was like, you could tell because it was loud. And I was like, this is weird, because there's full of people in the ring who I respected at the time. And I'm just really glad I got involved in that. It was a really nice experience.
And then, of course, as I spoiled earlier, you're in Big Massive Wrestling as well. 6-man match. I'm assuming you're the heels, because, or you're the bad guys, because who you're talking with. I've got Danny Edwards and Owen Jacks, who's now Jimmy Pierce, I think, who's going by, against Alex Parker, Jack McKenzie, and Donovan Vice. So I suppose big match wrestling's not a huge step away from where you started, because it's Frank Cross who promotes that one. So he, of course, is part of that company. But again, this guys you've been training with, was it quite a straightforward kind of thing, because it's people you're familiar with?
Yeah, I don't know if it says in their notes, but the match type was quite a weird one. It was like a six-man tag team over the top rope battle royal. That's what it was called. And it was basically that you could only get eliminated by getting thrown over the top rope. So, because we were told this like fairly, like just like a week or so before the match, and like, okay, we'll go for it. This will be fun. This will be inventive. We can do this. And it was fun to do, because it was like, right, we need to try and make it so we can seem like, it's so we can impress people and so we can get out there and do some nice spots and stuff. But we can't fall back on pinfalls and near falls and hot tags and stuff like that. We need to try and make sure this is like a realistic thing. So I think we worked it pretty well, because we're at this point in time, it was a mixture of people who had been wrestling on and off, like renting the wrestling, like mostly for maybe a year or two straight, on and off shows every weekend, and then a few people who'd only just begun, like myself. So it was a mix of like experience levels. But I think for the experience levels, we did the best match possibly could.
That, yeah, I didn't say that in my notes. That's a fascinating stipulation. I would like to see that kind of match, because it's not something you get nowadays at all. I don't think I've ever heard of it unless TNA did it at some point, but because they cycle through everything. But yeah, that sounds absolutely fascinating. So hopefully a big massive wrestling put it out at some point, because I'd like to see how that would work.
I'm pretty sure that it was going to become like a, not like a staple match type, but I think they're going to run it again. I wasn't sure who was going to win the next one, but I'm pretty sure they're going to run it again. But I think it might have been like Lucha, DS, and that were in the next one, because I know Big Massive were doing like a storyline with like the Luchadors, and I think they were going to be in it next, but I wasn't sure. But I was looking forward to seeing how different people were trying to do that match, because it was interesting.
Yeah, I mean, especially if you're putting in the Luchadors who are more akin with jumping over the top rope, trying to get that's fascinating. Yeah. Right, so well, like I said, we'll jump back and forth between wrestling and other stuff. But before I do that, again, in my research, you pointed out that Arn Anderson was one of your favourites, or one of the best. For someone who started watching mid-2000s, late 2000s, I suppose, how did you get into Arn Anderson? Are you big in research, checking network, and how did you get into him?
I was on YouTube just going through, like, I don't know if they still do it, but there used to be a channel that posted full matches, but it wasn't like matches from like a year ago or something, it was like matches from like 20 years ago. It was like one every day, and I just seen it on YouTube and I was like, oh, that's the Brainbusters versus I think it was the Heart Foundation. And I was like, oh, I've never seen that before, I'll get a watch, I know who Bret Hart is. And I watched it and I was like, this is really good, this is really, really good. And then I started getting more tag team wrestling from back then, and then I started watching a lot of singles wrestling from Arn Anderson in WCW in 91 to 94, when he was involved in, like, I think it's the Stud Stable, like Colonel Robert Parker. So he did, and there's a match I really like. It's like, it's not a long match, it's not like an iconic match, but I think it epitomizes like Arn Anderson. It's like him versus Mark Merrill. I can't remember what show it's on. It's like a WCW show in 94. And he was like a late replacement, and he comes in, and I love the match. It's like, what, it's so simple. It has a really good story, and Arn does some simple stuff that make him the bad guy. Like, there's a point at the start of the match, he doesn't like sneak attack him, doesn't grab his hair, doesn't poke him in the eye. It just goes to the ref. Here, close fist. He's close, like, get up, make him open his fist. So it makes him seem like, oh, he's taking a series, he's following the rules, but he doesn't like a punch for that. That's a serious punch. He's scared. So kind of like showing like that fine line you want to walk across, I think Arn was the best person possible for that. And then, of course, he's worked with the Horsemen.
Yeah, so any others that kind of...
Arn Anderson's retirement cross.
Sorry again. It kind of started out there. So Arn Anderson, yeah, he could cut a mean promo. I mean, if you're talking about the Horsemen, and you think your front men are Flair and I don't know, JJ Dillon, and they're doing all the talking, and then you've got a little bit of an ace in the hole behind you with Arn, who would just come and just wreck you, so he's like the guy in the pub that sits in the corner that everyone's afraid of.
Yeah. I've always said that I've compared him to, you know, Big Innes from Still Game. That's what he is. He is a Big Innes of wrestling. Like, because he's like this big guy. He's like, you look at him and go, he could do something, but if you just talk to him, he'll be nice to you. But if you mess with him, he's going to do you in. And I think that's great. And I would say he's probably the most underrated wrestler of all time. So I think back in the day, if you could give him like a singles title for a proper run, he would have done excellent stuff. Even away from the Horsemen, he could have been like the main guy. Obviously, never got an opportunity because there were so many big personalities back then.
And especially with like the story aspect of your enjoyment for wrestling, did you find that back then it was a bit more subtle storytelling, things like that, where nowadays there's still a bit of subtlety, but mostly it's on the camera, this is the story.
Yeah.
You're doing the story.
Like, I like long-run storytelling, and I think the Horsemen's one of the best stories of all time. It's like, the amount of times, like, they broke up, they got back together, they broke up, they got back together. It's this brotherly love between Rick and Arn, which you couldn't separate. And I thought it's just, like, wee small details like that. And, like, I love WCW from, like, 90, I think it's 91 to, like, 96, just before the NWO come in, when it got a wee bit more cartoony. I love the kind of old school wrestling variation of that. I think it's great. It's like the same reason why I love like WrestleMania 2 to WrestleMania 7. Because like they are like just small events, but they're full of wee small great stories. I just love it.
So speaking of stories, the other thing I learned in my research is you're doing lit. You're also an aspiring journalist. You do a little bit of writing for the likes of the local, the independent, and little indie blogs. So what got you started and what inspired you to be a journalist and write for these places?
Well, I got an opportunity to do that when I was in fifth year in school. Like, my English teacher said, "Hi, Paul, I know you like writing and stuff. Then there's a small opportunity for like a you get to go to the Sun, you get to go to like a football game and report on it, get to report on the Glasgow Games, which were that summer." And I was like, yeah, cool, I'll go do it. So I did it and I fell in love with journalism. I got to speak to some great journalists over the time who I've kept in contact with, and they still like give me pointers and stuff. And I mean, like, and I got to do stuff that I never thought I'd get to do. I got to ask questions at a press conference at a football game, which was really fun, which I ended up getting told off by because they thought I snuck in, which was quite funny. Yeah, I asked them, I don't know who the Rangers manager was at the time, but I asked them a question. I was like, if you don't win like this year, do you think they're going to get the sack? And the Rangers like media team pulled me aside and went, who do you work for? I was like, I don't work for anybody. And they went, why are you here? I was like, oh, I'm doing an apprenticeship thing. And they went, you don't ask any questions anymore. And I get sent to the back. And I was allowed to be in like the press feed box thing anymore. And I told them, oh, but I just get kicked out of that. And then, why? Because like, I asked a question. And they weren't expecting us to ask questions. It was just meant to be there so you could get the feel of it. I just took the bottle and asked a question. Because what are they going to do? Let's be honest. What are they actually going to do? That's the worst thing they could do, was kick me out. So I did that. Then I got to go to a few gigs and got to report on them, which was really fun. And then the big one was the Glasgow Games, which I got to report on the events, and then I got to be part of the promo material. Like, the Glasgow Council did a big mass promo thing. I got to be involved in that. I got to pitch some nice events, like local events and that stuff to do. And I was involved in the setup of a concert in George Square, and I was involved in that setup and reviewing that stuff, and it was a really nice experience that summer. It was really nice, and it set me up for that push into journalism in my sixth year and into my like university degree.
So it said that you were kind of brought into it because your teacher noticed that you enjoyed writing. Is that something that was kind of a hobby of yours? Did you do kind of reviews for things before you went into that kind of stuff? Or did you just do short stories? What was your kind of writing genre?
It was more short stories, because I've always been a bit of a storyteller. I always liked writing a story. I always said, I'm going to write a novel one day. And then I set my laptop and write the first chapter and never go back to it. That kind of stuff. And I was always, whenever we got the chance in school to write a short story, I'd be coming up with mental ideas and doing unique stories and going past a word count by 1,000 words and having to edit it down and stuff. And I think storytelling, anybody can be a storyteller, and I just love that, because you could go out and write about anything and everything you wanted, but it's still a story and it's your story, and that's the best thing about it.
I remember when I enjoyed doing that as well, writing stories, but I never got to me ages to get past things in English because I didn't know how to finish a story. My conclusion was always the worst bit. So there was a good streak of short stories, creative writing, where my main character would die at the end, because I'm just like, there's an end. Sweet, dead. I don't need to think about anything else. Eventually got there. But yeah, it was always that ending. That's why when we do this podcast, and again, don't know if you listen to any of them, the ending's always the most awkward bit because I don't know how to finish it. So I'm just like hoping for the best that we'll just kind of trail off and then I can end the call. But yeah, so it's very fascinating. And of course, that will help with again, yes, we're concentrating on these stories, things that being in wrestling, having ideas and trying to move the story where you want it to go because you've got this kind of creative drive to it as well.
Yeah, it's like a thing, I remember when I, just before my debut, they were asking, what's your song going to be? And I was like, I don't know. It's like, I mean, there's no come out to music. And I was like, you can't do that. And I was like, how? I was like, you can't do that. You can't do that now. And I explained, I wanted to do the thing. It's an old school heel tactic from, I think it was like Smoky Mountain Wrestling. Jim Cornette used to do it a lot, where he'd have his heel on the main event come out to no music. And it just because it'd usually be something that was really hated. Like, I don't know if you've watched Dark Side of the Ring, but they do the New Jack episode. There's a New Jack match they do, and it's him in the main event. And he was that hated. They come out to music and immediately screams and people flinging bottles at him and people cursing at him and telling him to go back, and it's horrible stuff they're saying, but you can tell he's the most hated man in that room, and it's the perfect heel story. And I was like, I could do that, I'd be great. But then I get to explain to me, nobody knows who you are, this is your debut, you're not going to get anything, you're just going to have a no reaction. I was like, that makes a lot of sense. So one of my things is I want to eventually be that guy who can come up to no music and he'll get the reaction of, that's the bad guy. And I think that'd be quite cool.
Yeah, so one of those moments where you skip to the end of the story before you having to actually do the story bit to get there.
I've come up with so many ideas. Like, I love old school wrestling. It's like one of my favourite things is to just watch, like, not even just American old school wrestling or British old school wrestling, although I do have a deep appreciation for that, especially people like Fit Finlay and William Regal. But it's more like, I like watching old school Japanese wrestling, like Old Japan. It's like, I love like Bruiser Brody, stuff like that, and like Dr. Death Steve Williams when they went over there, and like Stan Hansen, because they were treated as the worst people in the world. They were treated as the bad guy. Like, one of my favourite stories is the when Vader first went over and they beat Kenta Kobashi. Not Kenta Kobashi, it was I can't remember who he beat now, but he won the IWGP title in his first match, and people were flinging steel chairs and that at him from outside the ring because the guy was a legend. That's going to really annoy me what his name is now.
Oh, hang on, right. We'll figure it out while we're doing this. So,
Vader's first match in Japan.
Right, hang on. This will be thrilling for people that are
the suspense
on the audio. I know. Right. So, after winning the final match of an 8-man tournament against Shinya Hashimoto, that can't be right. Yeah.
I thought it's
Inoki.
It's the first. I can't remember his name. It's going to remember me. I'll see if I can get it up. Inoki. It's Inoki because the same actually knocks about his Inoki's eye lippy. That's what the story is. That's why it is. That's why I remember that.
Oh, yeah. There we go. Yeah, the pro Inoki audience rioted, resulting in NGPW being banned from the Sumo Hall for a bit. Yeah, okay, that'll do it. Yeah, I mean, guys like Vader and Brody and Hansen, they suppose it's actually a testament how they're hated so much because they don't speak the language, so they're doing all their talking by their actions as well.
It's great. It's like, I don't know what it is, but I think, see people who aren't the most charismatic as well, see when they go to Japan, they can be kind of stoic because they don't have, like, they don't speak the language, so they have to rely on their actions. I feel like it's John Laurinaitis, when he went over as Johnny Ace, he was never the most, like, charismatic person in the world. Although he did try to be, he just never had that kind of stuff. That kind of emotion for it. But when we went over there, he was beloved because he was this bright blue-eyed baby face from America who'd come in and fight the good fight. And he didn't have to speak, say a word. It was all through actions. I think that's amazing how you don't have to be, oh, I'm the big bad guy. Although I love doing it, you don't have to do that. You can just do it with actions. That's brilliant.
Especially weird, that kind of style at the moment. I mean, especially in the US when there's no crowd. I don't know how they're doing it. I think there's a post, it might be down behind a paywall, telling you what they hear when they're in the ring and the Thunderdome and stuff like that. But it's such a different beast. I mean, for yourself, you've only wrestled in front of people. I mean, 800 people as well, which is like you say, you couldn't see, but you could like hear and feel the people. How do you think you'd fare in front of TV screens and nothing?
I hate it because I always like to, working to crowds because you get a reaction off them. So say if it's someone like, in a headlock, you look at you point at one wee guy and go, "This, I imagine this is you. Ah, this is me doing your Dan. Ah," like just try and get them to hate you. Or, like I remember like, being told, like I think like Lou King Sharp and I've said this before, but they say like, point at, make one wee guy hate you. Make one person hate you, and eventually they'll all hate you. And it's great because like, if you look in somebody's eye and go, "This is sore," and the whole story is like, if you can make the guy who brought his way in there, that doesn't really think it's real, you're doing your job right. Like, oh, I know this isn't real, but that looks sore. And like, I think that's what I tried to do. But see, because in a ring when nobody's there, it's just feels a bit empty.
Yeah, I mean, like, but watching it is weird as well because you're kind of dictated what your reaction should be. So you're being told what to do. It's like dance, puppets, dance.
Yeah, I don't think I could watch, like, unless it's, you watch certain styles of matches and it works fine. Like, I think ROH did, I think they've done a couple of good matches which have released, which there's no fans in it. But that's because it's more a technical style, it doesn't rely on a crowd. But I think if you're watching like a WWE or a AEW, they need sound, and it's hard to watch wrestling right now. That's why I've not watched a lot of like major wrestling in the last year since like there wasn't any fans because I find it so difficult. Like even though some of the matches are great, like I remember was it Roman Reigns versus Jey Uso. I remember picking that matchup because I was like, that's gonna be a good match in general. I watch that, and that's the only match I watched for that show. Even though it was really good, I still, there was just something about it which I couldn't say that was sensational because the crowd wasn't there. And I feel if that crowd was there for that match, that's incredible. Even though the Thunderdome's there, it's just not the same.
Yeah, it is an odd thing. I mean, because of lockdown, I've watched every pay-per-view this year just because this is where I work now. I work from home. But it is an odd experience. And the only it's like good thing out of it is the shows are shorter. That's what I'm kind of dreading because we're recording, of course, it's the week before WrestleMania. And I don't think my body's trained to be WrestleMania ready. I'm happy being like watching a show, finishing at 1:30 and going to bed. I don't know if I'm ready for WrestleMania yet because I'll have fans at least.
Yeah, I think the thing as well, I'm quite dreading it because I'm busy the day of the first night of WrestleMania, so I won't be able to watch the day after as well. So I'm going to have to watch, I'm going to try and watch both days on the same day because it's the only day I've got free. So I'm going to try and watch the full thing over and see if I can do it. I'm going to try and space it out. If I can't, I'll probably just pick and choose. But it's going to be difficult because they shows in general are too long. I remember, was it not last year's WrestleMania, but the year before, it was like 8 hours long. I'm like, that's too long for a wrestling show. Wrestling shows should be at least 4 hours maximum because there's just too much. Like, if there's too much wrestling, you'll eventually just die. And I felt really bad. Was it the women's main event with Becky, Ronda and Charlotte? I felt really bad for them because that crowd wasn't having that match because they were...
I think...
Did I stay up? Really bad.
But yeah, I think the pre-show started at 10 o'clock and it finished at 4:30 or something like that. And I don't think I know I didn't take the day off. I didn't book the day off afterwards because I wasn't planning on staying up for it. And yeah, that was an awful Monday.
Yeah.
I didn't stay up.
I watched the first half of the show. I think I finished around. Was it the Triple H match? It was Triple H Batista. I stopped after that match and I watched the rest of the day after.
If I don't watch it live, I probably will never get around to watching it. So,
that's it. I don't like spoilers either. Because you go on like Twitter or you go on Facebook and all you see is, oh, look at this. Spoiled the whole card. Like, you've ruined that for me now. I don't want to know who wins because that's kind of important.
Yeah, a wee bit. Right, so what's your aspirations then with the writing? Is it do something more national or are you wanting to get into wrestling writing? What's your kind of your plan with that?
I've always said that my wrestling and my writing, I'm going to try and keep them separate as possible because I feel like I'm quite an opinionated person. I don't know if you've been able to tell, but I'm quite opinionated when it comes to wrestling and like I don't like sharing my views too much about wrestling. It's more of a wrestling's my personal thing. I'm going to keep it personal. That's when I do writing. It's about music, it's about politics, something that's quite, everybody has an opinion on it. Wrestling's quite a niche environment, so I know if I say something people don't like, I know people are going to go, oh, bad stigma about him. He doesn't do this, he doesn't do that. So I kind of keep it separated as much as possible. And as well, wrestling is like, I like to see, I think wrestlers, see if you wrestle because like, unless you're going to like try and keep both of them, because doing both of them, sometimes like lines might be crossed. And like sometimes I think keeping them separate is a good thing for me personally, because I don't think if I was doing wrestling, writing and wrestling at the same time, I feel like I'd eventually get a bit too much. I'd get a bit too boastful for myself, and I think that's quite a wrong path to go down. So I don't want to do that. So I try to keep them separate as possible.
Yeah. Just as you were speaking about that, that makes sense, because it's one thing doing a review of a show and just going, oh, I didn't like this way this guy did that, and then you'll come to the next show and they're at that show. And yeah. Wrestling is, I mean, just by the fans, is a toxic environment for opinion. Everyone's opinion's wrong. That's pretty much the long and short of it. So, I know for myself, when I do writing, I always got accused of being too positive because I don't like negative stuff. I don't see the point of being dwelling on that kind of thing. So, yeah, writing is a difficult thing if you're trying to balance both, especially if you're doing it yourself as well, because that's just a one-way ticket to not being booked places, because you said their mate was a bit rubbish one day.
Definitely. Like, and it's bad that that's a thing that happens, but it happens everywhere. I'm pretty sure, like, I know this has happened before. I've given a bad review to a band and then tried to get a press pass for and told no because of what I said. So It's not something. It's not something negative. This could be a good thing.
It's thin skin, as it seems to be. Even from the people that are supposed to be the biggest, the standard bearers, everyone. One negative thing could be just like, nah, you're not getting in. I'm not going to allow you to have your mind changed. So it's a weird environment. So I'm quite happy to stick with doing the podcast now, where I can ask the questions and they can do the answers, and then I could just jump in with some sort of weird random story for myself. I don't have to form that many opinions. You've put down, well, your Twitter profile has got the hashtag for the craft. Where did that come from?
That was for me trying, like, this is when I was just starting wrestling. I was trying to do a couple of like, oh, what would my name be? Oh, what's like, you know, like when you see like a t-shirt on like WWE.com or something, or like when you're going through, I try to design my own t-shirt, like, oh, they've all got a slogan or something. I'll try and do something like that. And it took like a lot of different tries. For the Craft wasn't the first thing I came up with, but For the Craft is more something I came up with just before my debut, and it's more something that I've wanted to do for a while. And the idea is basically like the old school, I'm doing this because the craft is sick, it's dying, that kind of old school. Wrestling isn't the same anymore. Why is wrestling like this now? Basically, like an old school like guy from back years and years ago. Oh, I hate this now. All the young guys doing flips. I hate that. Like, because people, we've all seen that before. Like, oh, that wrestling Twitter's moaning about people doing flips. I was trying to get that in wrestling because I like that kind of stuff. Because it gets it. People don't like it. People want to see big flashy moves. They want to see people being nice and happy. They don't want to see an old crabbit guy walking about the place. So that's what I'm trying to be. I'm trying to be this guy who's, I'm taking it back to the roots. I'm just going to, this is real to me. This is user of playing wrestler, that kind of stuff. I've always wanted to, like, I think that kind of stuff's intrigued me because it falls in the same line of, I kind of believe half of it, I kind of don't. I know wrestling evolves, but I like old school wrestling personally. So it's kind of that kind of idea. So it comes to the heart.
Yeah, so kind of like a throwback. So a bit like the Revival, would that be kind of that?
Because, like, I think the Revival are great. I love their matches. Like, I think one of my favourite tag team matches of all time is them versus DIY. I don't know what card it is, but it's the two out of three falls match. That's because that's a great match. It's honestly so good. And I feel really bad. They were good. Especially in WWE, they had a lot of wasted potential. They could have had so much more. But I hope they're doing, like, I've not seen a lot of the work. I've seen their match with the Young Bucks, but I hope they're doing well for themselves.
I can neither confirm nor deny because I don't watch AEW or I watch bits and pieces of it, but it's not for me. But when you go back to that throwback thing, yeah, I mean, I suppose a lot of it nowadays, good or bad, is GIF wrestling.
Yeah,
it's enough to just get you in that 5 seconds, and then it goes vital, and everyone wants to see you wrestle. And it turns out that's all you do for 5 minutes, which is great. But like yourself, I like a story. I like to know why this is happening. And
stuff isn't a bad thing. Well, I'm just gonna say this because it's not a bad thing. I think if you've got one move and you do it excellently, and that comes at a GIF, that's great. Like, personally, I think I'd do an okay spine buster, and if that turned into a gift, I'd be like, cool, that's fine. You've seen one of my better moves. Cool, that's a teaser for the rest of the stuff. It shouldn't be, this is what I do, it's a teaser for the rest.
Yeah, absolutely. Can't agree more with that. So as far as when the shows return, if they ever do, which is hopefully, I think hope is the end of this year, start of next, yeah, hope, is kind yeah. of thought. But I think it's going to be into late 2022 at this rate. I mean, by the time that I get vaccinated, you'll still be like 6 months away because you're so much younger than I am. What's your thoughts? What's your plans? Is just get yourself reacquainted with the ring? What's your immediate goals?
Well, I'm one for always learning, and when I come back, I'm going to, at least for another 4 or 5 months, I want to go back into training. Bring myself back up to the standards I was beforehand. Or even better. because I feel like if I think it's dangerous people going like 6-7 months without training and then coming straight back in the ring, because your body's not going to be the same. You might be fit, but your body's still not picked. It's still not got everything it used to have every week in and week out. Pardon me. So I want to go back in and pick all my technique back up, make sure it's all sharpened and get the principles of wrestling back to like standard I want it to be at. So it's going to be that. Then hopefully after that, it'll be going back on the shows, try to get my best as possibly can and try and get my character out there more, because I feel like I'm quite inactive on Twitter on purpose, because I feel like if, especially people who have characters on Twitter, they kind of like ruin them. Say for example, like I don't have a particular example in head, but people can use Twitter for their benefit. Like I know, is it Curtis Chapman, the one that used to wrestle for Red Pro? He's really good on Twitter because his character is the annoying guy, so he's great for that. But if your character is, oh, I'm a big bad monster guy, I've got a big scar on my face, I'm the devil or some crap, and you're on Twitter tweeting Cody Rhodes going, oh mate, that match was class, people are like, oh, what? What's the point? If you want to do that, like, have a personal account. That's why I've got a personal account and a wrestling account, because I can say my wrestling opinions on my wrestling account and then do the rest on my personal account. That's why I try my best to separate wrestling from like Paul the wrestler and Paul the person.
Yeah, that's a good thought. It's trying to strike that balance, because there has been, once lockdown started, of course, there's been people that have used it to build their character that are actually wrestling. Guys like Emily Hayden being an example, who's just really yeah, phenomenal. And then there's guys that haven't actually debuted yet trying to get their character across before. I don't know if it's not short-sighted, but it's a case of we didn't know how long this is going to last. So now they've started doing a character a month into lockdown. We're now a year in, and they're either running out of ideas or they've overexposed their ideas and they haven't even wrestled yet.
Yeah, it's like, as well, I know, like, I've seen this before, that trainees who have been training for maybe like 6-7 months messaging promotions going, oh, by the way, here's my CV, I've trained here, that's all in your CV. It makes you look unprofessional. It's I know you're trying to get yourself out there and you're trying to do your best, but I've always been in the standline that if you're wrestling and you're still a trainee now, see until your trainer says, but no, you should be working as much as you possibly can and starts helping you make the CV, you shouldn't be sending CVs to that point. Because until you've had your first match properly and other promotions have started trusting you to work in the ring, you shouldn't be sending out CVs, because it's just irresponsible, because you've got one match. That one match was probably practiced 15, 20 times before you actually wrestled it. So it was down to a T. You don't know what it's going to be like when you show up to the show and it's this guy from England who you've never met in your life who works a totally different style from you, and you're just thrown out there for 5 minutes and it's terrible and you end up hurting yourself. That's the kind of idea. I don't like that. That scares me. Especially during this now, because everybody's so desperate to wrestle again. But we just need to slow it down and realise that wrestling will always be there. We just need to take our time.
Absolutely. So would you say, like, for the first period of you being a wrestler, companies, not saying this should be the example across the board, but companies should come to you before the first little bit. And then once you feel comfortable enough to be going, right, I could probably put together a 5-minute match easy with anyone, then you can start going, right, I'm going to put my CV out to this place, to that place, and which kind of what you're getting into.
More even this, that your trainer says, right, I trust you in my ring, I think you'd be okay to do other rings, and then start sending your CV out more. Because eventually you do have to start sending your CV out to places that you've never heard of before. But right now, like, if you've had one match, that's not you. Like, I probably won't start sending CVs out until I've had another couple of matches either. I'll probably come back to training, make sure I'm sorted, and then if I feel like I've got my mojo back, I'll start sending some more CVs out. and start getting properly back in, because then I'll trust myself. It's all about self-trust as well. You can be confident in yourself, but you can't be overconfident.
Absolutely. And you're a product of a training school, and if you hurt someone, or if you overextend and end up hurting and just damaging yourself, or that's their reputation online as well. So I can absolutely understand your logic and thought process into that as well. But an overarching story, we've talked about story that much, that's all I've got in my head. Overarching goal, is there any companies in the UK, Scotland, that you want to try to aspire to get to? What's you feel comfortable?
Everybody's got the same one. Everyone's got the same in the UK they want to do. Like in Scotland, it's ICW, Disco, like SWA, the bigger ones who form in big crowds and stuff. That's the ones everybody's trying to. Then we come to the UK, we've got Progress and Attack and all the small indie ones who are got Buzz and like Red Pro, who have got connections to other companies. But I've always looked for, I'd love to go over to Germany. I'd love to, hopefully, once everything's sorted, I can go over and do the WXW, do like the 8-week training program. I'd love to go do that. I think it's a really interesting style with interesting coaches. I'd love to go abroad and do that. I'd love to learn more from different styles of people. Like, I don't know if you know, but I'd love to see, like, maybe go get a seminar with, like, Doug Williams, and now he's back in wrestling. I think he's amazing. He's, like, he's probably the best British wrestler to come out of the UK in the last 20 years. Because he's revolutionised wrestling for the UK. He's done stuff that nobody in the UK thought was possible, for being honest. Like, William Regal and Fit Finlay were the start. Then it's him and Drew. And now we've got NXT UK coming back into the fold. So I think that's great.
Yeah, I don't know why it came to head, but when I speak to people and I kind of get an idea of places where I think that would probably be a good fit, and WXW was the one that came to my mind as soon as you started thinking about branching out. I don't know why. I think they always have kind of this like old school reputation where you'll get a high flyer match, but generally you'll get like a Bad Bones just battering folk. So
I miss Bad Bones. I really do. Bad Bones was good. I loved when Stephen, he was like quite popular and it was like wrestling week in and week out around the UK. That was great. I love Bad Bones. He was like such like a no-nonsense big bully character. You could literally put him at any promotion in the world. Be that a family show, be like a indie show, be like a like even like a hardcore show, and he'd work every style. It was great.
Would he be like a dream opponent for you? Have you got any dream opponents that you'd really want to get in the ring with, other than Doug and maybe Bad Bones?
Yeah. Well, in the UK, there's a few. Like, I'd love to wrestle Daz Black. Both came from the training school, and he's an excellent wrestler. He can work multiple styles. I'd love to, like, we've done training stuff together, but I'd like to work a proper match with him. Then out with like proper big names, I'd love to wrestle like Mark Coffey, like previously mentioned. I'd love to wrestle Bailey Matthews, William Regal's son. I don't know if you've seen his match with Tyler Bate, but it was great. Tyler Bate's another one I'd love to wrestle. Noam Dar, love to wrestle him as well. Austin Brooks from Source. And it's because we grew up together. He lived in the flat below me when I was from to about 8 years old, and it's kind of weird that we both didn't talk about wrestling when we were younger, but we've both went down this path now, so I think that's really interesting. And we're also from the same school. Same with like Jimmy Pierce, we went to the same school. We'd love to wrestle him again. And like Logan Smith as well. Logan Smith, we've had a one or two training matches, and there were these nice hard-hitting match, and I'd love to go back and wrestle him again.
One of the names that just jumped out at me there was Tyler Bate, who I got to see wrestle. I've seen wrestle live once, and it was in Aberdeen for WrestleZone. And man, that guy's just, I don't know what it is. He doesn't do anything particularly flashy. He does a couple, like, does the cool bounce off the ropes, rebound, all that kind of things. But he doesn't do anything particularly flashy, but you just believe every move and twist and point and everything. It's just he's a phenomenal wrestler. I'm hoping once things open up, he'll probably be jetting across the Atlantic very, very soon.
I think his match with Waller was probably my match for the year last year. That match was sensational. Waller was another one. If I hadn't beat Will Lewis or wrestle, I would love to wrestle Waller. Even if I was coming in just to be a guy who'd come in and just squash, I'd love to do that anyway. I think he's so intelligent in the ring. And he's so simple. He's that 80s style bad guy that we just don't have anymore. I don't know why he's I know he's just came over and he's wrestling Ciampa next week. I don't know if it's happening still or not, but I'd love to. He's just great. He's one of my favorite wrestlers now. I think he might be my favorite wrestler right now because he's so believable. His match with Ilya Dragunov was so good, genuinely so good. And I felt bad for both of them because they both looked so. And if you look at a match like that and you go, that was a war, I love that. I love wrestling that's just a massive war. And you know it's everything at them. Because that's the story they're telling, that one can't topple the other. So nobody's hurt. So see if you're not going to match. And say, for example, Brock Lesnar went in and went for a match against a random guy. Say Xavier Woods, and just in 2 minutes destroyed him. That only helps Brock Lesnar. But if they go in there and Xavier Woods puts up a fight, it makes him seem like he's not lost anything. He's put up a fight against one of the most dangerous people in the world. So that kind of thing.
A name that came to mind there when you mentioned Walter, Rampage Brown seems to be a guy right up your street then.
Yes, I do love Rampage. There's so many people in wrestling who are so good, and it's so hard to recognise all of them. Rampage is so good. And Rampage deserves everything he's done because he's had a tough go at some things, man, because he's had to fight through a lot of stuff and a lot of struggles coming through. And he never got that spotlight, but now I'm glad he's getting the spotlight now.
He's definitely got that Arn Anderson, not old man, but just a tough, scary dude. But I'm sure I hear multiple stories, people speaking to him, and he's just the soundest person on the planet, but he looks like he would just batter you.
He's grizzled, that's how I always drive him, because I remember he was one of the first people I met when I was helping out doing my dues at a show. I think this would have been, I don't know, I think this was in Greenock. He wrestled a match, I think it was against Drew when Drew was still over here, and they two had a nice pull up, a big massive brawl, and I got to speak to him backstage just for 2 seconds, but he had time for everybody, even trainees would go, oh, how you doing, and shake their hands and made everybody feel welcome, which was great.
So before I round up the show today, I've got our two ridiculous questions. Again, I don't know if you listened to any previous episodes, you'll probably know what these are if you have. The first one is, what's your favourite dinosaur?
T-Rex, man. Big bad guy, T-Rex.
Of course it is. From our hour-long chat just now, I had to be a T-Rex. And the other one is, what would win in a fight, 2 sheep or 1 cow?
I'd go a cow. I'd say cow would batter a sheep. Sheep seem a wee bit timid. They run away from you. So a cow just comes storming in. Cow would batter them up.
You might question what kind of cow it was, because I've had that already as well from someone else.
I was going to ask what kind of cow, but I'm just going to go, any type of cow would beat a sheep, because sheep aren't scary. Cows could be scary.
Right, so that's that. Usually I try and just put them in randomly throughout the show, but I was just enjoying speaking about wrestling that I totally forgot about until the end. I've had a fascinating chat. This has been an hour long. So before we go, what's your social media? What social media do you want people that are listening to a wrestling podcast to know?
It's Paul Dawson _PW for Twitter, and that's all I've got right now. I warn you now, if you do see me, I will be more active now because I'm looking to hopefully have a bit more character spotlight coming up shortly. I'm not going to promise this anything just yet, but shortly But that's Twitter, follow the Twitter. I might say some stuff about Arne Anderson. I might gloat about how good he is. And I might promote my own spinebuster. Just once.
Get the gif.
Yeah, get the gif.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for speaking to me today.
No worries.